hanging out there. You never know. I think they said we're supposed to have, someone told me we're supposed to have some, you know, possible wet stuff this afternoon, but hopefully we'll stay open before it gets in and just be wet. A few announcements for us this morning. Today is the last day to sign up for poinsettias. Sign-up sheet is in the hallway. They do cost $7.50 again this year. Next Sunday is the Children's Living Nativity Christmas Carol Sing and the Music Group Siberian Solstice, which you have another flyer in your bulletin today. Share that with someone. They will really, really enjoy that, and that is two Fridays away. Next Friday, we have the Community Christmas Program put on by friends in McClure, and that will be going on in Fellowship Hall. And then Rebecca is
tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night, is it here?
We'll be here at 5 in Logan Drive and be over to the old cemetery.
Okay. In case you didn't hear, Cindy, Rebecca Circle tomorrow evening. They're going out to eat. You need to be here at the church. They're leaving the church by 5. And if you're just going to meet them there at Hills, be there by 5:30, right? Excellent. Good, glad I was hearing that correctly. Say, there's another announcement that I am probably not even thinking of right now. So, does anyone else have any announcements that I'm forgetting this morning? Yes, ma'am.
For the children's program and the musical program on Halloween,
cookies
donated.
Okay. In case you didn't hear Cindy on that one, we can use cookies and things like that, you know, holiday treats donated for Saturday, next Sunday for the Children's Nativity, and for the following Friday for Siberian Solstice performance. Would there be any others this morning? No? Okay, well, I'll turn it over to Bill for birthdays and anniversaries.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Anybody have a birthday they want to acknowledge today? I see some hands back there.
Tristan's birthday is Friday.
Tristan's birthday is Friday. Any other birthdays? What are you pointing at, Kevin? Going to be 21 again, Cindy?
Going to be
52. Any other birthdays? Well, let's sing happy birthday. come near Matthew 3, verse 2. John the Baptist's words shake us to the core. He made clear that the way to prepare Christ's coming is to repent. Using Isaiah's words to remind us that the way of peace is the way of righteousness and forgiveness. God, you know the place in our hearts that are tight with tension and unrest. With each breath in and each breath out, help us to know more deeply the way of peace. Amen. Open your hymnals to page 201 for the Advent prayer. Merciful God,
you send your messengers to the prophets to preach repentance and prepare the way of our salvation. Give us grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may celebrate your glory, the commemoration of the Nativity, and may await it with joy in the coming in glory of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who lives and reigns
for a response to reading this morning. Psalm 72. Give the king your justice, O God.
And your righteousness to the world's son.
May he judge your people with righteousness.
And your forward justice.
Let the mountain bear prosperity for the people and the hills in righteousness.
May he defend the cause of the poor of the people, give deliverance to the needy, and crush the oppressor.
May he live while the sun endures, as long as the moon, throughout all generations.
May he be like rain that falls on the mown grass, like showers that water the earth.
In his days may righteously flourish, and peace abound. So the moon be no more.
May he have dominion from sea to sea, and from the earth to the ends of the earth.
May his foes bow down before him, and his enemies lick the dust. May the kings of Tarshish and the Isles render him tribute. May the king of Sheba and Seba bring gifts.
May all kings bow down before him, all nations serve him.
When they call, and poor those who have no helper.
He has pity on the weak and the needy,
and saves the life.
And saves the life of the needy.
From oppression and violence, he redeems their life, and then precious is their blood in his sight.
Long may he live, may the gold of Sheba be given to him, may prayers be made for him continually, and blessings invoked for him all day.
May there be abundance of grain in the land. May it wait on the tops of mountains. May its fruits be like Lebanon.
And may they blossom forth in the cities like the grass of the fields.
May his name endure forever. His fame continue from all his son. May the people bless themselves by him. All nations call him blessed.
If you would, at this time, let us turn to the back of our bulletins to our prayer list. The brief addition to our prayer list, last name on there, Dwayne Sugar, is my youngest brother. He had a heart attack this past week, and if you would, please remember him in your prayers as he goes through his recovery. And if you would, also remember Donna Green in your prayers. She had a hip surgery this week, and it was a little more of a struggle on her than they expected. So if you would, please keep going with your prayers also. Are there any updates on others that are on our prayer list or ones that we'd like to remember in prayer this morning. Well, if not, let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for each other. We thank you for the feelings we felt as we gathered together. And we thank you most of all, Lord, for the smiles that we were greeted with from those around us. We come together this morning, Lord, and we open our hearts and we place all those who are there in your hands. We ask, Lord, that you will move, that you will do your amazing things, that you will help us to notice, and that you will help us to tell others all the amazing ways that we see you move. We especially thank you, Lord, for having been with us in the week that has just passed, and your promise to be with us for the week to come. We ask, Lord, that you'll especially be with the ones we've mentioned this morning. We ask, Lord, that you'll be with Donna, that you will touch her body, and that you will help her to get better, and that you will allow the healing process to allow her to be able to get back to doing the things that she likes to do. Continue to keep her in your hands. We also ask, Lord, that you will be with Wayne, that you will touch his heart, that you will help his body, and that you will help him heal, and that you will help him be able to get back to doing all the things that he normally does. We also thank you, Lord, for each of these others who are on the prayer list. We ask, Lord, that you will be with each of them, that you will be in every situation, in every circumstance, and in every heart, that you will touch their lives in ways that it enables them to share your joy and your love, that you will help all their days to be good. We pray for our communities, Lord. We thank you for them. We thank you for the safety, the peace, the security that you pour out upon this land. And we just ask, Lord, that you continue to keep your hand upon them. We ask, Lord, that you will speak to our leaders, that you will help them to hear your voice, and that you will help them to do things that are good for all of us. We also pray, Lord, for those who watch over us and take care of us. We pray for those, Lord, throughout our community to do that for us. And we just ask, Lord, that you will continue to be with them, that you will help them to do the many things that make our lives good. We also ask, Lord, that you will be with those who are in the military. We ask, Lord, that you will surround them with your shield of strength and protection, that you will help them to do the many difficult tasks that they are called to perform. We ask, Lord, that you will bring them safely home to us, and we pray, Lord, for those who do not come home safely. For those who are injured, we ask, Lord, that you will give your healing both in body and in spirit. And to those that do not come home, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you will pour your comfort, your grace, your peace, your presence, and your love out upon their loved ones, and that you will help them to know that they and their loved ones are in your hands. We also pray, Lord, for those who are in the nursing homes. We ask that you will allow their days to be good, and that you will have smiles upon their lips and joy in their hearts. We ask, Lord, that you will bless those who take care of them and those who visit them, and you will allow all their days to be good, and the halls to be filled with your joy. We thank you, Lord. We pray all these things in your Son Jesus' holy name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you would, let us turn in our hymn books to page 213 for our next hymn this morning. Lift up your heads, you mighty gates. Thank you. Isaiah, from the 11th chapter. A shoot shall come out of the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his eyes hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion and the fatling together, and the little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the ass. And the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain. For the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. Our New Testament reading comes from the Gospel of Matthew, starting with chapter 3, verse 1. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, the kingdom of heaven has come near." That is the one whom the prophet Isaiah spoke of when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all of Judea were going out to him and all the region along the Jordan. And they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourself, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees, and every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance. But one who is more powerful than I am is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." Lord, bless these your holy words that we do hear. Second Sunday of Advent. Peace in the house of the Lord. Peace. That's something we struggle for this time of year, it seems, isn't it? It seems like all the hurriedness of everything going on just makes everything impossible to really just enjoy a holiday season, right? All the worries about who you have to get for, all the worries about all the places you have to be, all the worries about all the work you got to get done before year's end in that last week of the year where, well, you know, nothing really gets done then, so it's all got to get done now. John the Baptist knew that people had their everyday worries in his day. And he knew that there was the vast majority of those who were hearing his call were coming out because, well, that was their biggest worry. Their biggest worry was not whether they were children of Abraham, whether they had all their business handled, but whether they would actually get into the kingdom of heaven. Because for so some reason, after all their sacrifices, he still felt dirty. He still felt bad. He still felt wrong. And so when they hear John saying, repent, confess before God what you've sinned, be baptized, be clean. That's a good ring to it, doesn't it? If everything you've been doing year after year after year doesn't feel like it's taken any of that away, what John's doing is offering something amazing. Not that baptism's new. It's not new to John. It's not new to his days. Before you could walk up the temple steps, and I mean this, before you could walk up the temple steps, you had to walk down into one of the ritual baths, go through, get down in there, get the water all up over your head so you're washing all the evil of the world off, and then as you ascend the steps to be able to get up to the temple, you're supposed to be feeling good because you're coming to the house of the Lord. But how can you feel good coming to the house of the Lord when every time you come to the house of the Lord, they remind you, and everything that's going on in life reminds you of the struggle you have with feeling good enough for God? Everybody knows that struggle, don't they? We all know that struggle. None of us are good enough for God. Not a single one of us. None of us are Jesus. None. Nothing you do will ever make you good enough for God. You are not Hercules. You will not be able to perform the eight wonders, the eight tasks, the eight burdens. You cannot even carry your own burdens by yourself, can you? And that's what was making things such a struggle, because of the way the Pharisees and the Sadducees were placing everything on rules and laws. You can't do this, you can't do that. Well, you can't do this if you've done this, but you can't do that first. Crazy rules. Binding people up, leaving them trapped in their horrible places. That's why Jesus came. That's why Isaiah spoke those wonderful words. One is coming who will see us differently. Who will see that everything we do is because we have been hurt. And we're just afraid of being hurt more. Because that's what really frees us from forgiving, isn't it? Fear that it's going to happen again. They'll just do it again. So what if they did? You're breathing, right? Has anyone done anything to you so bad that it has taken your life? Has anyone done anything to you so bad that has taken away your permanent joy? I mean, maybe they've done something to you so bad that every time you see them, you get this really sour, nasty, miserable look on your face, and your heart hardens, and your stomach churns. But who's doing that to you? Are they doing that to you, or are you doing that to you because you haven't let that go? Which is it? Peace in the house of the Lord. That's why the church has struggled over these years, because we have not had peace in the house of the Lord. We're very good about talking righteousness and peacefulness and love, aren't we? We really are. We're great at talking it. I know I try, but I know that I'm in a constant struggle between looking out for someone whose rights are being trampled on and looking to someone that is feeling afraid and trying to help them. That's an interesting place to live. How many of us live there in our homes? We do, don't we? If you've got kids in your home, you live that struggle every day, don't you? If you've got someone else in your home, you're living that struggle at least once a week, right? No matter how simpatico, everything goes together so good, right? Now, if you're living by yourself, you're probably even still doing it at least once a week, because you know then well you're going to let yourself down and disappoint yourself, right? And so every time we look in the mirror, we see that time where we just let ourselves down, right? God does not want us to live in that place. He wants us to have nothing to do with that place. That's why grace is so strange. Because grace says, because you're not good enough, I'll do it. I'll take care of it. I'll take that step out and show you that you have nothing to fear. I will come to you and do this for you. But we still fear. We still are aware that there's a chance, there's a good chance, that something's going to get to us again. That's why Peter asked Jesus, how many times should I forgive someone? He said, 7? Yeah. See, I picked a good number. More than once. I know he wants us to do it at least twice. 7. And Jesus says 70 times 7. That's one for every day for a year, isn't it? In other words, we should forgive everyone. Now that's hard, because let's face it, we know what happens in life. We know that people are not treated with justice, that we feel very much like nobody understands us, that we feel very much like we are weak, that we are powerless, that we have no one to look out for. But Isaiah's words reminds us that the one that was to come has come, and that he is our advocate. And that's all we got to do is just trust on him. Now that's the hardest thing to do, isn't it? Because, well, like everything else in this world, we believe God has let us down, don't we? Be honest. Because God knows it. God knows we feel he's let us down. How many of us are in our dream job? I am. Okay, I ran from it for many, many years, but I am in my dream job. This is where I'm supposed to be, and I'm really pleased that I finally got my head to where God could actually use me. You know, God has you where he has you. Most of us, well, when I was a teenager, let's see, it varied between astronaut and Cincinnati Red. Right? Right? What do yours vary between him? A meteorologist. What else? That's it? Okay. Cool. Good luck working towards that. When I was your age, I had no idea that this is what I was supposed to be doing here. So I have a couple more years to find that. Like I said, what would be better than making $12 million to $20 million a year playing baseball? What would be better? That's why I can't imagine those guys when they play all these sports, that they don't play every play with the hugest, biggest smile on their face. They're playing a game. And it's their dream game, most likely. It's that thing that they grew up dreaming about from a little child. And yet even they get so disappointed in everything because, well, this muscle didn't work right, or I dropped this ball, or I missed that one. Right? And everything's just horrible. Can you imagine if you were with Durbin, kicker for Ohio State last week? Imagine how good he felt. He'd been perfect all year long. And last week he missed 2 field goals. He was in his dream job. He was in his dream place. And it still didn't turn out the way his dream would have wanted, did it? most of us feel that God has let us down because, well, any number of reasons. We're not tall enough, we're not pretty enough, we're not smart enough, we're not rich enough. But I would tell you that we all have these wondrous things because of the way God has already provided for us. And the hardest thing is living in the moment. During Advent, we want Christmas songs, don't we? Unless we're shopping. And then we prefer to hear nothing. Oh, they're just trying to, no, they're trying to make you feel better, believe it or not. But they are reminding you about how everything's building up and hurrying up and doing this. And think, well, gosh, if those Christmas songs are really true, I'm probably not paying enough attention to the real reason for this season. Does that one beat you up too? How can we get on that? Grace. Just pure grace. Because that's what Jesus came to give. Have you been, if you've been reading the Advent devotionals from Society of St. Andrew that are in the hall for us, talk a lot about the fear that is in the world today. When you turn on your evening news, every bit of news that is on that news that is being reported out of fear's sake. Not out of information's sake. It's not out of goodness' sake that you need to know this. It is out of fear's sake. So that we can keep you riled up and you can keep turning into our news channel so that you can see how unsafe you are. All the rioting, all the shooting, all the natural disasters, all the everything. It's just so you can stay more and more and more riled up and on edge and keep you, just like the rest of them that are doing, and they want you to just get going along. That's what it does. I'm going to ask you to do something strange this morning. I'm going to ask you to close your eyes this morning and consider where you need peace. We're going to do this for a couple of minutes. Close your eyes. Think about the places in life where you need peace. Whether it's at work, whether it's at school, whether it's at home, whether it's coming before God, think of those places you need peace. Inhale and exhale. Slowly and purposefully thinking about those areas. With each inhale, try to breathe in peace. And with each exhale, try to breathe out that turmoil. Just give it to God on your breath that He gave you. Allow Him to fill those places where there are fears. Allow those fears to leave. And allow Him the places in our lives that were once filled. Help Him. Ask Him to fill those places. Dearest Heavenly Father, You know all the places in our lives that are tied to tension and unrest. With each breath in and each breath out, help us to know more deeply the way of Your peace. Help us to know more deeply the way of Your love. But most assuredly, Lord, help us to feel You. Help us to feel Yours. Give us that assurance that You love us, that You are willing to take these things from us to free us for joyful obedience in You. Help us, Lord. As each of these places, as we expose them to You, that You will take them, that You will do something amazing with them, that You will take away the fear, the hurt, the sorrow, that You will replace it with Your joy, Your strength, and Your happiness. Be with us. Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
page 7 in our handbook. Let us join together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the very day He rose again, He descended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God in one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done Your will. We have broken Your law. We have rebelled against Your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. As forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity and made covenant to be our sovereign God and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, you promised to be with us always in the power of your word, the Holy Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread and he broke it. He passed it amongst the disciples and said, "Take and eat, all of you. This is my body given for you and for many." And after supper, he took the cup. He blessed it. And he passed it amongst the disciples and said, "Take and drink, all of you, from this. For this is my blood poured out for you and for many as a sign of the new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me every time that you do it." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in.